35. Heresy uses power to oppress the proper nature. Mind monkey, bagging treasures, conquers deviant demons. His nature's perfect, thus he knows the way. Turning, he leaps clear of the net and snare. To learn transformation's no easy thing. Nor is it common to achieve long life. Luck changes him to things pure and impure. Free of faded kalpas, he moves at will. For countless eons, he is fancy free. A ray divine, fixed always on the void. The meaning of this poem, you see, subtly corresponds to the wonders of the Tao attained by the great sage Sun. Since he had acquired the true treasure from that demon, he concealed it in his sleeve, saying happily to himself, "Though that lawless demon tries so hard to capture me, his efforts are no better than the attempt to fish the moon out of water. But when old monkey wants to catch him, it's as simple as melting ice over fire." Hiding the gourd, he slipped out the door and changed back into his original form. "Monster spirits!" he shouted. "Open the door!" a little fiend said. "Who are you that you dare make noises here?" Pilgrim answered. "Report at once to those old lawless demons that a sun pilgrim has arrived." The little fiend dashed inside to make the report, saying, "Great king, there is a so-called sun pilgrim showing up outside our door." "Worthy brother," said the old demon, deeply shaken. "That's bad. We have stirred up a whole nest of pestilence. Look. The yellow gold rope has caught a pilgrim sun, while the gourd has stored up a grimpil sun. How can it be that there is another sun pilgrim? It must be that they have several brothers and they have all arrived." "Relax, elder brother," said the second demon. "This gourd of ours can hold up to 1,000 people, and we have only one grimpil sun inside. Why worry about another sun pilgrim? Let me go out and take a look. I'll store him up also." "Do be careful, brother," said the old demon. "Look at that second demon." Holding the specious gourd, he walked out the door as resolutely and confidently as before. "Who are you?" he cried. "That you dare make noises around here?" Pilgrim said. "So, you don't recognize me. I lived at Flower Fruit Mountain. My home, the Water Curtain Cave. For disturbing Heaven's Palace. I ceased to strive for a long time. Lucky to be freed of my woes. I left Tao and followed a monk. To reach, obedient, thunderclap. To seek scriptures and right knowledge. When I meet wild, lawless demons, I work with my mighty magic. Return my monk of great Tang. That we go west to see Buddha. Our conflict will then be ended. And each one can enjoy his peace. Don't stir up old monkey's ire. Or your stale life will expire. You come over here for a moment," said the demon. "But I'm not going to fight with you. I'm about to call your name once. You dare answer me. If you call me," said Pilgrim, chuckling, "I'll answer you. But if I call you, will you answer me?" "I call you," said that fiend. "Only because I have a treasure gourd which can store up people." "What do you have that makes you want to call me?" Pilgrim said. "I, too, have a little gourd." "If you do," said the fiend, "take it out for me to have a look." Pilgrim took the gourd out of his sleeve, saying, "Lawless demon, you look." He waved it once and stuffed it immediately back into his sleeve, for he was afraid that the demon might want to snatch it away. When the demon caught sight of the gourd, he was greatly shaken, saying, "Where did that gourd of his come from? How is it that it is exactly like mine? Even if it grew from the same branch, there ought to be some difference in size or shape. How could they be exactly alike?" With complete seriousness, he said, "Sun Pilgrim, where did your gourd come from?" Pilgrim, of course, did not know the history of the gourd, but he turned the question around and asked instead, "Where did yours come from?" Not realizing that it was a trick, the demon thought that it was an honest query and he proceeded to give a complete account of its origin, saying, This gourd of mine came into existence during the time when chaos divided and heaven and earth were created. There was then a supreme primordial old patriarch, who through death changed himself into Nuwa and took on her name. She melted stones in order to repair the heavens and save the mundane world. When she reached a crack in the northwest region at the base of the Kunlun mountain, she discovered a strand of immortal creeper on which was formed this red gourd of purple gold. It is, therefore, something handed down by Lao Tzu until now. When the great sage heard this story, he at once used it as a model for his own account, saying, "My gourd also came from the same spot." "How so?" asked the demon. "Since the division of the pure and the turbid," said the great sage. "Heaven was incomplete at the northwest corner, and earth was incomplete in the southeast corner. The supreme primordial Taoist patriarch through death changed himself into Nuwa. After she had repaired the heavens, she journeyed to the base of the Kunlun mountain, where there was a strand of immortal creeper on which two gourds had formed. The one I have is a male, while yours is a female." The fiend said, "No need to distinguish the sexes. If it can store up people, it's a good treasure." "You are right," said the great sage. "I'll let you try first." Highly pleased, the fiend leapt into the air, held up the gourd, and cried, "Sun Pilgrim." When he heard the call, the great sage replied in one breath 8 or 9 times without stopping, but nothing happened to him at all. Dropping down from the air, the demon beat his breast and stamped his feet, crying, "Heavens! And we say that only human life has not changed in the world. Even a treasure like this is afraid of her mate. When the female meets the male, it ceases to be effective. Why don't you put yours away?" said Pilgrim, laughing. "For it's old monkey's turn to call you." Swiftly somersaulting into the air, he turned the gourd upside down and took aim at the demon, crying, "Great King Silverhorn." Not daring to close his mouth, the fiend made his reply, and instantly he was sucked into the gourd, which was then sealed by Pilgrim with the tape bearing the words, "May Lao Tzu act quickly according to this command." Secretly pleased, Pilgrim said, "My child, you are going to try something new today." He descended from the cloud, holding the gourd, and headed straight for the lotus flower cave, every thought of his set on rescuing his master. The road on that mountain, you see, was pockmarked with holes, and he, moreover, was somewhat bow-legged. As he scurried along, the gourd was shaken repeatedly, and soon there came from within a loud swashing sound continuously. "How is it that it swashes already?" you ask. The great sage, you see, had a body which had been so thoroughly refined that he could not be dissolved speedily. On the other hand, the fiend might know some such paltry magic as mounting the clouds and riding the fog, but he had not been completely delivered from his mortal constitution. The moment he was sucked into the treasure, he was dissolved. Pilgrim, however, did not quite believe that that had been the case. "Oh, my child," he said, laughing, "I don't know whether you are pissing or gargling, but this sort of business is most familiar to old monkey. Not until after 7 or 8 days, when you have become thin liquid, will I lift the cover to look. Why hurry? What's the rush? When I think of how easily I got out, I wouldn't spy on you for 1,000 years." As he held the gourd and talked to himself like that, he soon arrived at the entrance of the cave. He gave the gourd a shake and it was swashing even more loudly. "This sounds like the rattle of a fortune-telling tube," he said. "Old monkey should make an inquiry to see when master can come out of this door. Look at him." He shook the thing in his hand constantly while reciting the classic of Change of King Wen, Great Sage Confucius, Master Zhou, of Lady Peach Blossom, Master Ghost Valley. When the little fiends in the cave saw that, they cried, "Great King, disaster! Sung Pilgrim has stored up our second great king in the gourd and he's using that for fortune-telling now." When the old fiend heard these words, he was so horrified that his spirit left him and his soul fled, his bones weakened and his tendons turned numb. He fell on the ground and began to wail, crying, "Oh worthy brother! When you and I left the region above in secret and found our lives in this mortal world, our hope was to enjoy together riches and glory as permanent lords of this mountain cave. How could I know that, because of this monk, your life would be taken away and our fraternal bond be broken? The various fiends of the entire cave all began to wail aloud. When Zhu Eight Rules, hanging there on the beam, heard the wailing of the whole family, he could not refrain from calling out. Monster, don't cry. Let old hog tell you something. The pilgrim son who arrived first, the grimpel son who came next, and finally the sun pilgrim who came last, all three of them are in fact a single person, my elder brother. He is very versatile, knowing 72 ways of transformation. It was he who stole your treasure and had your brother stored up. Since your brother is now dead, there is no need for you to mourn like that. You should clean up your pots and pans quickly and fix up some dried mushrooms, fresh but on mushrooms, bean sprouts, bamboo shoots, soybean cakes, wheat glutens, wood ears, and vegetables. Invite us master and disciples for a meal, and we will be pleased to recite for you once the Receive Life Sutra. Infuriated by what he heard, the old demon said, I thought Zhu Eight Rules was a guileless person, but he's actually most sassy. He dares to make fun of me at this moment. Little ones, stop mourning. Untie Zhu Eight Rules and steam him until he's soft and tender. Let me have a full stomach first, and then I'll go catch Pilgrim Sun to avenge my brother. Turning to Eight Rules, Sha Monk chided him, saying, Isn't that nice? I told you not to talk so much.